Just over a year ago, I made this video, which shows off a simple prototype for a tiny game that I just started with the Godot game engine. 1,200 commits, 25,000 lines of code, and over a year of work later, well, let's just say the guy talking in that video is a naive baby that has no idea what he's getting himself into. In this past year, a lot of crazy stuff went down. Over 20,000 people have playtested my game, and I've turned that little prototype into something that is really starting to feel like a fully featured game. And because Blargus of the past did such a good job making devlogs document the whole process, present day Blargus has lots of fun then versus now content to show off. And since this has turned into such a massive project, I think it'll be fun to dive in and show off what a really big long-term Godot project looks like, and discuss how I'm feeling about my decision to go with Godot instead of, you know, one of the more mainstream engines. So that's what this video is, a recap of all the blood, sweat, and tears that went into taking this simple prototype and turning it into what it is now. Alright, so in the past year, I think the development process I've gone through can be broken up into three distinct phases. Getting something playable, finding the fun, and then production and polish, which is basically the phase I'm in right now and probably will be in for a very long time. So, starting with getting something playable. The original vision for Blood Thief was a mix between Quake and Hotline Miami, but in kind of a spooky, dark fantasy type setting. So in the past, I would do this thing where I'd work for months and months on a project, and then like a year in, I would realize, wait, this is terrible. And so I knew from the get-go I wanted to do this one differently. This one, I was gonna try to get a working prototype up and running as quickly as possible, just so I could see sooner if there was a nugget of something good, and then I would have something to iterate on. And feasibly, I could release. Which that's basically the goal for this game, is to release it. Okay, so what's the minimum amount of stuff this game needs just so I have something to play? The way I see it, that just means a player character that I can control, an enemy for me to fight, and a level for this to all happen in. So I basically grabbed the Godot default script for the character controller. I made like the worst, ugliest player model the world has ever seen, and I made like these absolutely terrible animations for him. And then I made this knight character, which actually is pretty good, at least for my typical standards. That's using Mixamo animations, and his AI is just to like run straight at you basically. And guess what? That's exactly what's still in the game now. So good job, Blargus of 2023. For the level, I did exactly what you're not supposed to do, which is instead of just throwing together something simple that has a start and an end, I made this absolutely absurd geometry node system that was supposed to be this awesome dungeon generation thing that would make it so I could just pump out levels like crazy, and it was super ambitious. And guess what? I ended up throwing all that away. So let this be a lesson that in the prototyping phase, keep it simple. So yeah, what I ended up with was just like a couple cubes basically with torches and doors and stuff. But hey, it was made with cool geometry nodes. So be impressed. So at the time, this was really exciting for me. I had a really bad game, but it was a game and it was playable. And kind of like how I alluded to before, I had something that I could iterate on now. And so that brings me to my next part of this video, which is finding fun. So one thing that I felt would make the game more fun is just to make it more challenging. And the next thing I did was make a variation of the knight that had a bow and arrow, which really did a lot for making the game more challenging, because now you actually had this fast moving projectile that you had to dodge, and you couldn't just run straight at the knights anymore. But what about this default character controller that I'd basically been using since day one? Like I said earlier, I wanted this game to be a lot like Quake, and in case you didn't know, Quake's got like the best movement ever. So I basically did a bunch of research on how Quake's movement works and modified Blood Thief's movement to just basically feel like Quake's movement. Which at the time I was like, wow, this feels exactly like Quake's movement. But now that I'm watching this back, I just was not there yet. But hey, we were starting to get somewhere. So one of the other inspirations for Blood Thief is Hotline Miami, which is like extremely fast paced. So the other big thing that I did was I just cranked that movement speed way up. So basically Quake's ultra fast movement, but faster.
Zing and Pep. See, those are the kind of words we're looking for. Yes, Jim.
What about if we did an even newer voicemail message that had even more zing and pep?
Now we're cooking.
Also, as I alluded to earlier, the game was just too simple and there was a notable lack of skill expression in the game. The thing about Hotline Miami is that the combat mechanics are really simple. The main way you express skill in that game is by how you move through the space. I wanted Blood Thief to be like Hotline Miami, and that movement was going to be paramount. But I was finding that just running around and slapping enemies with your sword in kind of the Hotline Miami style just didn't feel like it provided the player enough skill expression to make the game interesting. So it was at this point that I added wall running and sliding to the game, which now was making the game feel a lot like Quake plus Hotline Miami plus Titanfall. It also was really starting to sound like Ghost Runner, which definitely entered my radar around this point. And I saw the similarities as a good thing because I played it and it's freaking amazing. And now, because I had done a smart thing in getting the full gameplay loop set up in the beginning, the magic was starting to happen. I was starting to get that feeling of like, oh, wouldn't it be fun if I could do this? For example, when I slid into the knights, nothing happened, and it was like, oh, I should be able to knock the knights over. Wouldn't that be cool? And then the air dash came about because I was finding myself wanting to do these aerial attacks on the knights and just having a really hard time. So I made an attack where you could just kind of shoot at them like a heat-seeking missile. And then with all these new movement mechanics, it was way easier to come up with interesting level layouts and ideas because now I just had to think about sections that would encourage the player to use some of these new mechanics. It was at this point that I started using Trench Broom to make Blood Thief's levels, which I'll talk a little bit more about later in the video. So yeah, things were moving and it felt like I was making a lot of progress. But I stayed in this phase where I was basically just in my cave silently making this game by myself for way too long. I mean, if we look at my devlogs, I released that first devlog back in July 2023. And it wasn't until October 2023 where I actually started showing the game to people and playtesting.
Wait, the sensitivity is through the roof.
Yeah, sorry.
Can I turn it down?
No.
Can you even come in here? Oh my god, all right. Oh, my god! Bro, I can just use shift as like an ultimate shield. But it's like, This is so intense. Oh my god, I obliterated him. Oh no.
Oh god! Yes!
So that was just an initial playtest that I did with some of my close friends, but it was soon after that that I opened up Blood Thief to the broader community using Steam's playtest feature. When I started playtesting, I was still in the find the fun phase of my design process, and so it was when I started playtesting that I more than doubled Blood Thief's movement kit. Over the course of the next few months, I added the parry, the ledge climb, and the ledge vault, the crouch, which, don't be deceived, is a surprisingly deep and fun mechanic, and the ground slam as well as the ground slam bounce. I also refined things like the air dash quite a bit and turned it into something that was actually fun to play, which is what I talked all about in my last devlog. And so now this game that started out as Quake plus Hotline Miami is starting to kind of feel like Quake plus Hotline Miami plus Ultra Kill plus Ghost Runner plus Titanfall, which, I mean, dude, I'm liking how this sounds. But perhaps most importantly, throughout playtesting, I was able to identify exactly what Blood Thief's core gameplay loop was. What I realized was that while it's fun to explore the level for the first time, fight enemies, and just get through challenges without dying, through playtesting, I found a super fun metagame that I'd been missing was getting through the level as quickly as possible. In other words, when you get really good at Blood Thief, figuring out where the shortcuts in the level are, finding the fastest way to kill all the enemies, and mastering the movement mechanics so you can build and maintain speed are all really fun ways to make the game fun on a deeper level for hardcore players. And so in observing this in playtests, that's how things like the leaderboards and medals got added to the game. And with those additions, it started to feel like a little bit of neon white was getting added to this mix here, which also is kind of amazing because neon white fucking rules. So this exploratory phase of development was so enjoyable for me that I probably could have stayed in it forever. But it had become very clear to me that I had honed in on a gameplay loop that was really fun. And so if I wanted any hope of finishing this game in the next decade, I had to kind of stick my feet in the sand and decide that this was the rough gameplay loop I'm settling on. No more mechanics, no more scope creep, I'm moving on. And so that brings me to the phase of development that I'm currently in now, which, I don't know, probably has an official name. I'm calling it production and polish. Essentially, at this point, I have Blood Thief's mechanics largely locked in. What my focus is now is on squeezing as much juice in as many creative ways as I can out of the mechanics that I've set out, basically through a variety of challenges, levels, and enemies, none of which I can really talk about right now because that would kind of spoil the whole game. The other aspect of this phase that I can talk about is just adding a layer of refinement to stuff to make it, you know, as fun and enjoyable as possible. And when I say level of refinement, I basically mean replacing my buggy-ass code with code that actually works, and replacing my programmer art with slightly better programmer art. As for refining the code, it's so funny how a 100-line prototype can get you like 90% of what you want with just a little bit of jank, but getting that last 10% requires like a billion lines of code. One place where this is definitely true is with stairs in Blood Thief. Stairs are kind of famously terrible in video games, and Blood Thief is definitely no exception. You can think of Blood Thief's player character as basically a Roomba with arms, and as we all know, Roombas and stairs do not play nice. At first, I basically got around this by putting little invisible ramps behind all the staircases in the game, because Roombas can go up ramps. But I quickly started to lose my mind, putting little tiny ramps over every single little detail that the player could get caught on. So I actually had to implement a surprisingly complex routine to basically detect if you're about to hit a stair and gracefully move you up and over it. If you've ever heard of the open source project Godot Stairs, I'm basically using that approach. I'll link that in the description if you happen to have an infatuation with stairs. Another piece of infrastructure that started to explode in complexity as I started to add polish was Blood Thief's restart code. In the original version of Blood Thief, I was literally just reloading the entire level every time the player hit restart. This actually wasn't too bad. For me, it was like a 2-second stutter every time you hit the restart button. But Blood Thief is the type of game where you could die like 50 times in a level, and I just think that 2 seconds of wait time is just too long for a game like that. Funny enough, it's just short enough to not be overtly obnoxious. For example, like players weren't really complaining about it in feedback, but I think it's just long enough to slowly chisel away at your sanity in such a way that you don't even realize it's happening. Kind of like a leaky faucet that just drips every once in a while. I don't know why, I kind of just felt like I had a moral responsibility to reduce this loading time. Maybe that's just my software engineer coming out. So I redid the restart system to only restart the stuff that actually needs to be restarted, which is so much faster, like it's literally instant now. But this created like a billion edge cases, and now everything needs to know if it's the type of thing that should be restarted or not. So there's a whole bunch of like nasty race conditions and edge cases, and I turned my little one-liner prototype into an extremely bug-prone piece of infrastructure that I now have to think about for every single new thing I add to the game. But on the other hand, restart is like a billion times faster now, and so I'm still glad I did it.
Just working. Working hard so I can please you.
And what about me turning my programmer art into something that just hopefully doesn't look so much like programmer art? Well, for that, I'm just gonna say that I'm learning and I'm doing the best I can. I'm trying to leverage my programming skills by making cool looking shaders like this sky shader I made that is heavily inspired by Quake Sky. About a year in, I finally redid that terrible player model that I showed off in the beginning. Check it out, now we got fingers. And because I'm an idiot, I still haven't rigged the fingers for this player model. I literally modeled his hand in the closed position with the sword just being shoved into the player's hand like Squidward's jellyfishing net. In last video, someone suggested that I add little emotes like the player flipping their sword up in the air when they're idle. Hey man, that would require rigging the fingers, so it's looking kind of out of the question at this point. Unless we come up with some emotes that don't require opening the player's fist, like maybe he can just shake his fist angrily at the enemies or something like that. Oh yeah, and as for those hilariously jank animations I talked about in the beginning, those haven't changed. As for textures, I think I'm slowly starting to get better and better at making good textures. I've kind of got a process where I do some stuff by hand in Aceprite. Some textures are just sourced from textures.com where I pull them into Photoshop to make them look a little bit more blood thiefy. And I've actually started using Substance Painter for a few assets now, which, you know, I'm just learning. So if you're a real artist and you're looking at this, please don't make fun of me. And yeah, I think the art's at a point now where I'm actually feeling pretty good about it. I think part of being a game dev is just accepting what your strengths are, playing to your strengths, and doing the best you can with the other stuff. Okay, so that's basically everything that I've worked on this year, but I mentioned in the beginning of this video that I was going to talk a little bit about just what a sizable Godot project looks like. So here we go. So Blood Thief's currently using Godot 4.2.2. When I first started Blood Thief, I was using Godot 4.0, which means I successfully managed to upgrade it twice, once from 4.0 to 4.1, and again from 4.1 to 4.2. And oh, would you look at that, Godot 4.3 just came out, so I'll definitely be upgrading to that too, because Godot 4.3 has a ton of features and fixes that I'm just really excited about. So I was kind of shocked to see this. The project has 257 GD script files and 195 scene files. 67 of the GD script files and 10 of those scene files come from plugins, so not all of it is me. So if you're anything like me, you might be thinking, this project isn't that complicated. How the hell did he manage to write 256 GD script files? And as I look through all these, it starts to make sense. There's just a lot of random crap that you need to make a game like this work. A whole lot of these are UI, which I haven't even really talked much about yet. And this is hilarious because Blood Thief's UI is like as minimalistic as it gets, and it's a huge portion of the complexity of this project. I also use a lot of the entity component design pattern in Blood Thief, so a single entity like a knight, for example, has literally 18 scripts on it, with all these scripts being pretty tiny. So 256, not as big as it sounds. At a high level, I've got four key external integrations that Godot works pretty seamlessly with. So I've got FMod, Trench Broom, Jolt Physics, and Blender. In a nutshell, FMod is just really good for making dynamic music and sound effects. It's what I'm using for basically all my sound effects for Blood Thief. For example, I have this song by Occam's Laser, and I want to make sure that the intensity of the song cranks up at exactly the right moment in the game. So I've got these intensity regions set up in the level, and when I enter that region, the song will seamlessly transition to the more intense part. You set up all this logic in FMod, and it's actually a pretty easy tool to learn. I really recommend this for anybody who's interested in this type of thing because it's a lot of fun. I recently migrated all Blood Thief sounds to FMod because it just has basically every feature you could possibly want when it comes to sound. Like, for example, I have a bunch of different footstep sounds, and in FMod, you can really easily set up a random selector for all those sound effects. This is something I would have had to write a bunch of code for before, and now it's just like super easy to set up. By the way, I'm not sponsored by FMod or anything, I just like it. The other big tool slash integration that I'm using in this project is Trench Broom, which is what I'm using to make the maps for Blood Thief. Trench Broom is really popular in the Quake mapping community, which is basically how I found out about it. In short, Trench Broom allows you to not only do the modeling and texturing for your maps, but it also allows you to add entities to your map, like enemies, triggers, doors, and even define complex behaviors like making all these things interact with each other. And you do all this in Trench Broom. The way I'm shoving my Trench Broom maps into Godot is with a plugin called Funk Godot, which by the way used to be called Quadot if you've heard me talk about it before. The next integration I want to talk about is the Jolt Physics Engine. This plugin is literally just a drop-in replacement for Godot's default physics engine. I started using Jolt really early in Blood Thief's development because I kept getting caught in little cracks in my level geometry. I figured I'd try using Jolt, and the issue literally just went away. It's honestly one of those plugins that I just don't really have to think about, and isn't that just the best kind of plugin? Last but not least is Godot's Blender integration. My first ever YouTube video is a tutorial on how to set this up. A lot of people commented on that video that it's actually not that smart to use blend files directly in your Godot project, but honestly, if you're a small team, I'm not really convinced it's such a bad thing. For example, I found it really useful to be able to tweak animations in Blender and then immediately be able to see the change in-game. So yeah, it may not be best practice, but for me it's a useful feature. With that said, I do find myself just exporting my models to GLB more often than not nowadays, mainly just so I can use different versions of Blender and not break anything. I also find myself having lots of different versions of some assets, and only the final one actually gets exported to GLB and makes it into the Godot project. Okay, so I'd say that's a pretty good summary of the project as a whole. I don't really feel hampered with tech debt at this point. I mean, sometimes I'll come across an old script that I haven't touched in a while, and I'll see some scary shit that I wish I didn't, but that generally falls in line with my process for making new features, which is just do it in the dumbest, messiest way possible, and only later, once I've fully hashed out all the details and requirements of that feature, do I actually clean it up and refactor. Personally, I think that this is the best way to do things, because nothing is worse than some giant, over-engineered piece of infrastructure that adds hundreds of lines of code solving problems that don't actually exist. And how about my decision to use Godot as a whole? This is definitely a loaded topic that I could probably do a dedicated video for, but overall, still feeling really good about using Godot, and I have absolutely no regrets. Sure, it can be pretty buggy at times, but feature-wise, it really has everything I need, and I just have so much fun using it. I'm finding that I'm able to bring ideas to reality really, really quickly with Godot, and as someone that overall is just trying to have a good time in life, I can't really ask for anything more. Maybe I'll make a more thorough video about that another time. Let me know in the comments if that'd be interesting to you. All right, so that's basically my year of work summed up in a little video. It's been a lot of fun reflecting on all the things I've learned this year. As you can probably imagine, it's been a pretty crazy year for me. This channel has blown up way more than I ever could have imagined. So thank you to you for watching these videos. I love my life. I get to make games, and that's pretty incredible. So cheers to a year of game dev. To wrap things up, if you're interested in Blood Thief, give it a wishlist on Steam and join my Discord, because that's where I like to hang out and chat with people.
It's also just where you'll hear all the latest news for Blood Thief, and it's where I talk about what I'm working on. And if I ever do like a release or something like that, the Discord folks are going to be the first to know. I'll leave a link to wishlist and to the Discord in the description.
All right. Thanks for watching. Bye.